the consequences and also how to manage PCOS. So we have special guest among us, Dr. Lata R, Dr. Shilpa Singhi. So I request the chief guest to please to come on the dais. And also I request Professor Malini and Professor Sapna to please grace the dais. We would start this program by invocation by Yoga Lakshmi.
He Pratama Vandya Adi Deva Sharanu Yambena Sharanu Yambena Dukkadu Kuda Duramadi Dukkadu Kuda Duramadi Harasu Yambana He Pratama Vandya Adi Deva Sharanu Yambena Sagi Barali Vijaya Vindu Sartakateyu Irali Indu Sagi Barali Vijaya Vindu Sartakateyu Irali Indu Harasikayo Nammanu Harasikayo Nammanu Harake Serali Ninnanu He Pratama Vandya Adi Deva Sharanu Yambena Sharanu Yambena Thank you.
Thank you. Now I request all the dignitaries to inaugurate this event by watering the plant. Okay, and now I request Professor Malini to welcome all the guests.
Good afternoon, one and all. It's a great pleasure for me to welcome dignitaries on the dais and off the dais, dear students, research scholars, dignitaries on the dais and off the dais. So this is a really fruitful and a great event, because today we have two eminent gynecologists from Mysore. They are gracing this occasion and they are here with us to deliver a talk on PCOD. You must be knowing, in the present context, out of five, one girl . So we thought, let us have a knowledge, a feast of information related to PCOS or PCOD. Thereby it will enrich the knowledge. Thereby you will be knowing what exactly the disease and the management as well as the treatment part could be done well. So today both of them, they'll be talking about the PCOS. So first of all, it's a pleasure for me to introduce Shilpa Santrup, Dr. Shilpa Santrup from Gopalgowda Shankari Hospital. She is a very eminent gynecologist and IBS specialist. And with my request, with our busy schedule, even she agreed to address all the students, and followed by consultation will be there, free consultation. And anything more, if it is needed, even you people are requested to take their help or the suggestions in the diagnosis and the treatment part. So on behalf of University of Mysore and from the Department of Zoology, as well as from the Department of Genetics and Genomics, heartily welcome to you, madam, for this occasion. Another senior gynecologist, Dr. Lata madam, is here with us, and she is accompanying Dr. Shilpa madam. She is expert in gynec issues, especially PCOS and many other gynec problem. And today even she'll be giving talk related to PCOS and its management part. And from University of Mysore and from the Department of Zoology, as well as from the Genetics and Genomics, and from all of us, I welcome you, madam, for this occasion. And two of our guests, they were busy with attending some meetings. Rukmini Madegowda, mayor, she's supposed to come, but she got a call and she has to attend a meeting at 3 o'clock, and that's why it's not possible for us to grace this occasion. But later on, she told she will join with us. And our dean, he has some hostel issue, and he got a call from the registrar and he has to attend that. So we have a very dynamic personality in the campus. Everybody knows who is she, Professor Sapna. And for all our activities, Sapna and her team, they will be with us, and they'll always with us for all the activities which are going in the department as well as in the university. And from behalf of all of us, I welcome you, madam, for this occasion. And we have some senior faculties from sister departments and our own department. Professor Amrutoli madam is here. I welcome you, madam, for this occasion. And dean, we have wardens from hostels also. I welcome you, madam. And I welcome one and all for this great occasion. And I will give more time for them. Thereby, they will give a lot of information about the PCOS and other gynec issues, and how to tackle, how to manage the things. They'll be giving all the hints or the information related to that. With this, I welcome one and all for this great occasion. Please have good interaction. And after this, there's a consultation will be there, free consultation. Please make use of the opportunity as well as the facility. Thank you. Thank you, one and all.
I welcome Professor S.S. Panini for continuously organizing such informative sessions. Welcome you, ma'am. Now, I request all the dignitaries to inaugurate the session by watering the plant. Thank you. PCOS is a common multifaceted disorder found among females of reproductive age, presenting major clinical conditions of hirsutism, oligomenorrhea, and infertility. Socioeconomic studies from India have observed PCOS as a lifestyle disorder highly prevalent among middle and high income urban population as compared to rural population. An estimated 1 in 5, that is 20% of Indian women, suffer from PCOS. If not monitored in time, the condition has serious health impacts. So now today, Dr. Shilpa as well as Dr. Lata ma'am, they will be addressing this issue. So we have informative talks now. Now we will have the session started. So first you. Okay, first talk will be by Dr. Shilpa Santrup.
She graduated from JSS Medical College, postgraduate from JSS University. She is working as consultant gynecologist at Gopal Gowda Hospital. She has specialized in infertility medicine from Kiel University, Germany. Presently, director of IVF specialist at Siri Kari IVF Center, Mysuru. Principal of International Institute for Assisted Reproductive Technology and Research Center. I welcome you, ma'am.
Good afternoon, one and all. I know it's a post-lunch session, that's why I can see only a few attendees, maybe. But first, I would like to thank the University of Mysuru for giving me an opportunity to present the most dreaded, most, in trend disease, that is the PCOS or the PCOD, today in front of all of you. I would like to thank especially Professor Malini Madam for inviting me to give a guest lecture in this occasion. One day, Malini Madam called me and she just spoke to me, just we want to conduct a talk. More than education program, she was worried about the students, about the sufferings what they had. I think she had in-depth knowledge of her students, what they were suffering or they were undergoing through that. I think she has a good, with her talk, I could make out that she had a good interaction, good connection with her students. So it was more than it's an educational program. She wanted to help her students to come out of this disorder, or she wanted to see to that what best she can do for them. So I heartfully appreciate Dr. Malini Madam to involve herself, not only in the education, yes, she is already into the education field, she is already excelled in that. Apart from that, in person, heartfully thinking about her students' health, their well-being, she's into that. I was very, really happy. I thank you, ma'am, for thinking so personally about your students. I thank the other professors, Mrs. Chaitra, who continuously coordinating with me for this meeting. I thank Dr. Sapna, I just met her now, and all the students who are here on this occasion to listen to our talks. And special thanks to our Dr. Lata. She's senior to me, not only my colleague, I can even tell like she is the teacher and mentor to me. Like whatever position I'm there today is because of her. Because after my graduation, I started working in Gopal Gowda Hospital under them. For each and every case of mine, she and Dr. Shailaja, both of them were there to handheld me. And each case, even today, if I have any complications or any problem, first thing I call Dr. Lata, Dr. Shailaja. I thank Madam for accepting this, and today we have divided our topics so that I'll cover part of PCOS, the remaining treatment part and diagnosis management, which is very important. Dr. Lata will be more capable of dealing with those, so Madam will be talking about the other part. I want it to be more of an interactive session rather than like it's one-way communication. Already, we know what is PCOS or PCOD, because I think at least 10 to 20% of the people who are here might be suffering inside, who might not be able to, who may not be willing to come out to tell their problems, but they know what is PCOD. Can any one of you tell me what is PCOD or PCOS? Just a thing. Polycystic ovarian syndrome. Yeah, what is polycystic ovarian syndrome? What do you understand by this? In general terms, I'm talking, it's not a medical term or something. What about the layman? What do you understand by polycystic ovarian disease or syndrome? Yes. poly means many cis means cis, many cis are there, which is a ovarian disease, or we more of the we call it as a syndrome. Syndrome is a mixture of many diseases. Disease is one. Syndrome is a mixture of 2 to 3 diseases. We call it as a syndrome. It commonly what comes across us, what comes across us our eyes when we think about as a polycystic PCOD. A PCOD girl, when we think about a PCOD girl, what comes across our eyes? An ovulation. Any students? How do they look? How do they look? They look more obese. Anything else? Yeah, more hairs on the face. Yeah. So almost you people have told on the definition of PCOS. It's more of hairs on the face. That is nothing but we call it as hirsutism. We see abnormal hair growth on a girl's face. That is nothing but because usually the boys or the men have a growth on their face. That is the mustache or the beard. But usually girls should not have as a rule. When they have the mustache or the hair, abnormal hair growth, the beard on their face or increased hair growth peripherally on the hands, legs, this is called as a hirsutism or excessive hair growth. Why is this? What is the reason for that hirsutism? It's nothing but men has hirsutism, but women should not have. Why? What is the reason? Male hormones. The hair growth is mainly because of hair hormones. So that is nothing but increased androgens in a female body. Yes, androgens are more in a male body, but very less in females. Females all do have androgens. That is the testosterone and dihydroepiandrosterone. All these androgens are there, but in very limited amount, which is required for the regular metabolism of our body. So when it is present in excess in our body, it will manifest as, we call it as hyperandrogenemia, means increased androgen levels in the blood, that will manifest in the form of hirsutism. And also, have you seen the girls, young girls getting more of acne? Acne is nothing but pimples. That is also because of increased male hormones. That is the hyperandrogenemia. So we see hirsutism and acne. As madam told, it's an ovulation. What is an ovulation? Ovulation is like every month a woman should ovulate, means should release eggs for her fertility in future. But when there is hyperandrogen, when there is PCOD, the egg release is not occurred every month. That is called an ovulation. That will present as menstrual irregularities. When a woman or a girl is menstruating every month, that means ovulation is occurring normally every month. So she will not have any menstrual irregularities. Every month she will be having menses. When they have menstrual irregularities, what not having menses every month, once in 2 to 3 months or even delayed, that is also a symptom of PCOS. And what else? One more thing is what we told is obesity. So obesity is one of the cause as well as a risk factor as well as a feature of PCOS. So they will be obese. About 70 to 80% girls will be obese. What is obesity? Obesity is anybody know what is BMI, body mass index? Yeah, body mass index is nothing but it's the weight divided by height square, height in meters when we square it. For example, if a girl is 55 kgs, her height is 55, weight is 150 centimeters, if you take 1.5 meters square. So 55 by 1.5 to 1.5, so that will give you the body mass index. If it is between 19 to 25, that is the normal body mass index. If it is more than 25, up to 30. Okay. More than 25, up to 30, we call it as overweight. More than 30 and above, we call it as obesity. So obesity is associated with PCOS. Now I'll come into things a little in detail we'll go. Okay, so this is the definition of PCOS, polycystic ovarian syndrome, or the disease. It's nothing but it's the appearance of enlarged follicles or the cysts in the ovary due to abnormal hormones. You can see the uterus, the two tubes, and the two ovaries. When you take a cross section of the ovaries, you can see small, small cysts in that. Small, small fluid filled cysts or follicles. Those are called the polycystic ovaries. It's the most common endocrinopathy affecting the woman. Let's say endocrinopathy is the disease of the endocrine glands. That is nothing but it's a hormonal disturbance or the hormonal disorder. So it's the most common what we see in a which affects the woman in the reproductive age group. Reproductive age group is the age between 15 to 45 years, which take when the girls are able to reproduce. So, and it's also a leading cause of infertility in both India as well as worldwide. About 5 to 10% of the women in the reproductive age groups are being affected by this disease.
Sorry, it's not changing. I think you can change, no?
Okay. So, next is the, who first diagnosed this or who first identified the disease? It's two scientists, Teen and Levita. Those are the scientists in 1935, they first described the PCOS. There's a lot of women who are having infertility, who are obese, who are having hirsutism, and who are not ovulating regularly. So those two scientists together, they form a criteria and they named it as the PCOS, or it is also called Steen-Levitan syndrome. What is that? There are so many criteria which is used for the diagnosis of PCOS. I'll come to the diagnosis of PCOS in the end. So global prevalence is about 2.2 to 25%. Almost that 2.2% is a lower range and 26% is a higher range. Lower prevalence we see in case of very underdeveloped countries like Somalia or African countries where they have very poor nutrition, where the social conditions are very low, and also where the environmental conditions also very poor. Those kind of cases we see very low incidence of PCOS. But very affluent countries like US, UK and all, where they are really rich, high socioeconomic, where the food is very rich in the fat, carbohydrates and all, where obesity is more, we see more prevalence. In North India, when it was done in 2012, one study between the age group of 18 to 25%, the incidence was 3.7%. This was done only in North India, North and South India. So next comes the prevalence. According to WHO, the overall estimation is 116 million women. That is about 3.4% of the women have been affected by this PCOS. This is according to 2012 studies. Indian experts claim about 10% of women, that is 1 in 10 women of the reproductive age group, has been affected by PCOS. About 30 to 40% of the patients will present with amenorrhea or primary amenorrhea, and 80% oligomens, reduced menstrual cycles. So this is how, next one. But the incidence is very high in adolescent age group girls. Adolescent is like between the 13 to 19, what we call as teen age groups. The incidence of PCOS is very high. They come with acne, hirsutism, they come with polycystic ovaries. But as the age increases, as they become adults, 20, 22 and all, they disappear. The PCOS features disappear. So that is the reason why girls in the adolescent age group, about 30 to 36% they present with the PCOS, but we should not necessarily treat them as PCOS. Only after their teen age decreases, when they enter 2022, even if the symptoms persist, then maybe we can diagnose them as PCOS. Till that time, maybe we can keep a close watch on them, and maybe we can keep it in the loop to check for the PCOS diagnosis. There's a cross-sections study which was done by Bharati in 2017. This is a recent study done in India. It was done at around 1,000 girls, equally divided between 50% from the urban population, 50% from rural population. The prevalence rate of India about PCOS is about 6%. So this is mainly a questionnaire basis. The incidence was very, very high, 9% in urban areas and only 1% in rural areas. Why is this? We all know improved socioeconomic status, altered dietary changes, lifestyle modifications, reduced physical activity, all these things which increase the incidence in urban areas. And also urban girls, most of them were educated. They knew why, what the PCOS, they were aware of PCOS, but very 8% of the rural population, they were aware of the PCOS. One is because of lack of education, or also decreased prevalence in their thing. important thing regarding when we associate with Department of Genetics is there is a strong family history or genetic predisposition to the PCOS. That is the reason why PCOS has been evaluating. I think few of the pages have already done thesis on the PCOS, its genetic relation. It's very important. The next obesity. Next, the obesity is a very significant risk factor for PCOS. About 50%, that's what the study said. But what, according to our day-to-day practice, we have seen almost 70 to 80% of the PCOS women are obese, or either obese or overweight, as I already mentioned to you people. What is the mechanism for this obesity? Hyperandrogenemia. We know increased androgen secretion in the body, which will stimulate the deposition of the fat in the adipose tissue. We all know adipose tissue is a fat tissue which is present in our body. So increased fat deposition both on the adipose tissue as well as abdominal viscera. That is the reason for obesity. They have more of truncal obesity. Truncal obesity is like central obesity. That is their waist hip ratio. That is, they have more fat deposition around the stomach, about abdomen and the waist. That is the reason. That's it. Peculiar thing which we see apart from the other obese women. Next. So this is a study which was done in 2015, which detects strong relation between the genetics and the polycystic ovarian syndrome. There is a more genetic changes in the FSH gene. FSH is a follicle stimulating hormone. This is a hormone. This is a polypeptide where there is a genetic modifications which will lead to polycystic ovarian syndrome. Next. So this study 2019, it shows that ovarian, since there is genetic malformations in the FSH gene, this will lead to increased androgen secretion, thereby causing insulin resistance, that I'll come to later about the pathogenesis, and which is associated with high incidence of reduced fertility. Next. So this is how it looks on a scan. This is the pictorial diagram of PCOS, that's polycystic ovary. That's the how we see it in a scan when we do a ultrasound. That is the number of cysts which is seen. So this is a small thing. This we have to know about before understanding pathogenesis. We all know. Next, the back. Hypothalamus. That's a thing which we have in the brain. Hypothalamus. Next we have the pituitary gland. Then we have the ovary or the testes, which are the reproductive organs. The hypothalamus will secrete gonadotropin releasing hormone, which will act on the pituitary. This pituitary again secretes FSH and LH. These are the hormones which are related to our reproduction. Follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone, which will act on the testes in males and ovary in females. Both of them act. How do they act? They act in a way. Next. This is a diagram of a Graafian follicle. This is how our egg looks inside our ovary. The central part, what you are seeing, primary oocyte is the egg. And the surrounding what you call is the follicle, we call it as Graafian follicle. The purple color cells, we call it as a granulosa cells. And the outer, that yellow color, brownish color cells, we call it as a theca cells. So FSH acts on the purple color cells, that is the granulosa cells, and causes proliferation of it, increased growth of it, and releases estrogen. But LH, what we mentioned, luteinizing hormone, will act on the theca cells, what we call as brown cells, and increased secretion of androgens. What we are talking about, the male hormones. If there is increased secretion of LH from the pituitary, that will act on the Graafian the theca cells, increased secretion of androgens. That is the basis for hyperandrogenemia or increased secretion of increased androgen levels in our body. So next one, please. So this is how it happens. The LH acts on the theca cells, increased androgen secretion. That is the reason for our hirsutism or acne, whatever we see the hyperandrogenism. But there is, at the same time, decreased secretion of FSH. So decreased secretion of FSH, we cannot act on the granulosa cells. So there is follicle arrest. The egg cannot grow. The whatever ovum we see, it cannot grow. When it cannot grow, it will lead to anovulation. This is the basic pathophysiology of a PCOS. Next slide, please. So, but in normal women, what happens? LH will act on theca cells. It will secrete androgens. Then androgens are converted into estrogen, which is the female hormone. That is what we require. But in PCOS, excess androgens are there. So all the androgens cannot be converted into estrogen. So there will be increased circulating androgens, which will cause all the pathophysiology. Next slide, please. So it's a composition of so many things. One is endocrine disturbances. That is, it can cause acne, hirsutism, infertility, all those things. There is a reduced quality of life because they'll be obese, they have hirsutism, they have anovulation, they have menstrual irregularities. Lot of body changes that will cause hypertension, anxiety and depression and other diseases because of the increased secretion of androgen, decreased ovulation, endometrial hyperplasia. All these things which madam will cover in detail. I just going through it. Next one, pathophysiology. They have insulin resistance. What is insulin resistance? Insulin secreted by the pancreas of our body, we all know. So this insulin should act on the receptor cells or the target organs. What does it cause? It will cause uptake of the glucose. That means it reduces the glucose level in the blood. But what happens? There is insulin secretion is there, but there is resistance to this insulin secretion among these PCOS. So there will be increased insulin level in the blood, but that cannot act, it cannot function. So glucose is not observed. So there is increased level of glucose in the body. So they are more prone for diabetes or impaired glucose tolerance. That again causes, that will again act on this hyperinsulinemia, will act on increased LH already there. This again causes hyperandrogenemia. This is the basic thing, increased LH, increased androgen levels and increased insulin resistance. Next slide, please. So same thing, I have put it in one thing, increased LH, which increased androgens, decreased FSH, all these causes, whatever the hyperandrogenemia features and infertility. Same thing, whatever I explain, next slide please. Same thing, whatever I told, hyperinsulinemia and increased LH, I just put it in a diagram, that's it. Next one please. So this is the next slide. This is the hallmark of it. One is hyperinsulinemia is there. There's decreased sex hormone binding globin that is released by the liver, which will bind to the androgens. So there is increased androgens in the body. There is decreased sex hormone binding globin, which is able to bind to the androgens. So there is increased level of free testosterone, which will cause hyperandrogenemia. That's the old physiology. But ultimately, I just want to know you people to know there is only hyperinsulinemia, hyperandrogenemia, and increased LH. That's the whole thing. I'm just going in detail, that's all. So last we'll come to the diagnosis of PCOS. When we call it as diagnosis of PCOS, this is according to the guidelines which was done by the Rotterdam criteria 2013. According to this, we have to take three things into mind. One is androgen excess, what we thought, which is the signs of androgen excess is hirsutism and acne. Ovulatory dysfunction, that is the anovulation of the menstrual irregularities they can have, and the polycystic ovaries of the ultrasound. At least two of the three should be there to call the girl or the woman as PCOS. That's the whole thing. Especially when you have to rule out other causes of hyperandrogenemia like androgen secreting tumors, or if they are taking any drugs which increases the androgen level in the body. All these things you have to rule out. Any two of the following criteria, if they have, you can call them as a PCOS or polycystic ovarian syndrome. This is the whole thing I just want you to people to know. Coming to the last slide, what are the risk factors which can increase PCOS? One is obesity in childhood. That is the reason from the childhood, we need to maintain our body weight. It's not once we attain menarche or we become adolescents, we need to check on the weights. It is from childhood, we need to keep an eye on our body weight is very important, because we know most of the mothers, they want the child to be plumpy. If it is thin, yes, it is not a healthy child. That is not the criteria. From a healthy child is an active child which is doesn't have any diseases. That's all. It's not a, you need not have to be obese or plump. Acanthosis nigricans, which madam will go in detail in next coming term. If they have a strong history, family history of diabetes in the family, if they have a strong family history of diabetes, especially mother's side, the girl should be more, even more cautious or more careful of getting PCOS. There is a history of polycystic ovaries or irregular cycles in the mother or the siblings. If the mother is having a PCOS or a sibling, elder sibling, like sister or the first cousin who is having PCOS. Or when the child is low birth weight or a premature, when they have premature menarche, they attain menarche at the age of 9-10 years, that is not good. Then we have to suspect the PCOS. These are the risk factors which we all should know. We should educate the other who are near to us.
surrounding us, we need to educate them towards this. I hope you people understood at least little of this. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shilpa. It was a very informative session dealing with epidemiological part and pathogenesis, including hyperandrogenemia, increased LH, and also how it is genetically involved. And now we will check the diagnosis part of it by Dr. Lata R. Ma'am graduated from Mysore Medical College and she did her post graduation from Muller's College, Mangalore, Father Muller's College, Mangalore. Worked as lecturer at St. John's Medical College, Bangalore, and practicing OBG for the last 20 years in Gopalagowda Hospital and Banavi Hospital. Her field of interest is laparoscopic surgeries. I welcome you, ma'am.
Good evening, each one of you. At the outset, I would like to thank the Department of Genetics and especially Dr. Vasis Malini. And I also appreciate her concern for her students. I'm really happy about it when Dr. Shilpa told about that. Not every teacher is so concerned about the health of the students. They just want to teach, they do their duties and go away. But it's not so with Dr. Malini, and I think you're all very lucky to have her as your professor. And I also thank Dr. Shilpa for her kind words, saying that I'm a mentor. I think we did a lot of good work together with Dr. Shailaja, myself, and Dr. Shilpa in Gopalagowda Hospital, and hope to continue to do the same and serve the people as much as we can. Coming to the topic, PCOS, Shilpa has really highlighted very well. Everybody's understood the pathology and...
I will change your picture.
Okay. Physiology and pathology of PCOS. There's a lot of overlapping between what I have presented and what I'm going to present and what she's already done. But I don't think it will be boring for you, because I'm going to deal with the clinical features, the presentation and management of the PCOS as such. Next. How are we going to diagnose PCOS? Mainly, whenever a patient comes to us, first thing is we take the history. The detailed history of any patient will give us a clue to come to some diagnosis. With history itself, almost 50% of the diseases are diagnosed. We confirm that with examination, the way they present, certain clinical features are particular to certain diseases, and then reconfirm with diagnostic modalities like ultrasound or laboratory investigations, and then finally we treat them. But in PCOS, there's no need for us to depend totally on laboratory investigations. Only few things are needed. So we focus on history. That is regarding age at menarche. She already told you that precocious puberty, that is attaining menarche at a very early age, less than 10, you have to think of PCOS in future. And length of time between periods. The more the interval between periods, more of it is PCOS. And quantity of menstrual flow, that is oligomenorrhea. The less bleeding she has, the more of PCOS she is. Then presence of dysmenorrhea. It may be there or may not be there. Next. in development of secondary sexual characteristics. Usually, secondary sexual characteristics appear at the age of 14 with menstruation beginning at that age. If at all secondary sexual characters have appeared and still she is not bleeding, that means she has not attained menarche, then you have to think of mainly there is anovulatory cycle and so she is not bleeding and that is not shown as menarche. And obesity, increased weight gain. Mothers come with their daughters saying she is gaining weight too much. In span of 3 months, she's almost gained. Manifestations of hyperandrogenism. She already told you. Hyperandrogenic means exercise patterns. These definitely have an effect on PCOS because especially in urban areas, there is more of eating and less of working. That is why the incidence is more in the urban areas compared to rural areas. Next. So what are the symptoms they present with? Usually it is amenorrhea, that is not having menstrual cycle, or oligomenorrhea. This is seen in 87% of the PCOS girls. Oligomenorrhea is less bleeding. Then irregular uterine bleeding. They will have a cycle, they'll start, but they do not bleed for 1 or 2 days. Then they bleed for 2 or 3 days. Again, it stops and it may continue or may not. Then infertility. 20% of the females, they come with infertility. They are PCOS. And symptoms of androgen excess. Hirsutism, she already told you, that is excessive hair growth, that especially in the male pattern. And acne, which are not subsiding easily or which are resistant to treatment. And alopecia or male type baldness. Alopecia is hair loss. Then symptoms of insulin resistance. This is acanthosis nigricans and obesity or impaired glucose tolerance. Next. I will come next. This I've just mentioned, there are a few more slides on that. This androgen excess symptom, here you have hirsutism. Hirsutism is excessive hair growth, especially in the male pattern. I will tell you where all, which areas is considered, I will give detailed information. Then acne, which is resistant to regular treatment. Normally when girls get acne, they go to a dermatologist. Usually, if underlying PCOS is not treated, they do not subside. So you have to go for a detailed examination, detailed history, and you have to come to some conclusion, which I will tell you in detail what exactly you have to do. Then male type of baldness. Next. This is thick pigmented skin over nape of neck, inner thighs, axilla. This is due to insulin resistance. This is acanthosis nigricans. Next. What is obesity? We told PCOS girls are obese. When exactly will you call a girl or a lady, a woman, obese? So we have the chart here. Normal is between 18.5 to 25. Overweight is between 25 to 30. And obese class 1 is 30 to 35. Obese class 2 is 35 to 40. Next. Now coming to physical examination, you have collected a detailed history. Now you are going to examine her, and once you have taken history, you have come to some diagnosis. Now with clinical examination, you are going to come to confirm your diagnosis. What are you looking for? You have something in mind now. If she's got excessive hair, maybe you are thinking she's got hirsutism. Hirsutism may be because of hyperandrogenism. So what exactly you want to look for? You record her BP. You see her vitals. Normally when a patient comes to us, we see her vitals. Blood pressure may be high because they are prone to be hypertensive. And you check her BMI to find out whether she is obese or not. Then acne, are they severe? Are they persisting? Have they caused scars? Are they long standing? You have to check them. Then medicalization. Medicalization, clitoridectomy, this we may not do in all cases. Certain cases maybe we have to do, but it is a one of the feature. And thyroid examination for enlargement of thyroid nodule situated here in the neck. You will have to look for the thyroid nodule because you have to rule out thyroid disorders. Thyroid disorders could be two ways, both hypo and hyper can be there. Both can cause trouble, both can cause menstrual irregularities. So not to get confused with PCOS, you have to rule out other endocrine pathologies also. Thyroid is one of them. Next. Hirsutism. Where exactly you want to look for these? This is the presence of terminal coarse hairs in females in a male-like pattern. Prevalence is around in 50 to 25% of women, you find this. Next. Next. See, in hirsutism, this shows a pictorial representation of Ferriman Galway scoring. Where exactly you have to find? There are 9 spots where you have to find the male pattern of hair. This, the upper lip. And you give 4 scores. Minimal, it's 1. Until more, 2. Moderate, 3. And severe hair growth, it's 4. You give scores of 4. Chin, then upper chest, upper abdomen, lower abdomen, then upper arm, upper thigh, then upper back and lower back. These are 9 areas you'll have to look for the hair growth. Anything more than 8 is considered as hirsutism. Next. So how are you going to diagnose? You have taken history, you have seen the clinical features. How are you going to diagnose? As she's already said, there's a criteria, Rotterdam criteria. Out of the, there are 3 criteria. Out of that, even if 2 are positive, you should consider them as PCOS. And that is oligo or anovulation. So clinical and or biochemical signs of hyperandrogenism, or you're seeing polycystic ovaries when you do an ultrasound. And also, you have to rule out other etiologies. As I told you, hyperthyroidism or hypothyroidism, you have to rule out that. Once there is amenorrhea or oligomenorrhea, don't jump to the conclusion that it is PCOS. You have to rule out other pathologies. Rotterdam consensus is that it is a functional disorder. PCOS is a functional disorder. Next. There's no specific test. This is PCOS. We are going to do just one test and confirm that. It is not so. There's no consensus regarding specific lab tests for PCOS. You have to document hyperandrogenism. So what do you do for that? I will tell you next. Then you have to rule out other endocrinopathies. Then you look for metabolic abnormalities. And the underlying defects in PCOS are still unclear. Then however, insulin resistance and metabolic syndrome are common in both obese and non-obese patients. So that evaluation of glucose tolerance is recommended. What we feel, if it is obese, then we'll think, oh, maybe she's PCOS or not. Once she's obese, we will definitely jump into the conclusion of PCOS. But if she's a lean PCOS, then you'll have to redo the test. Next. So what test you're going to do? You do a free or total testosterone. Testosterone is a male hormone, that is the androgen. If it is in excess, definitely it goes in favor of PCOS. In serum sex hormone binding globulin, it is decreased. If at all, if it was increased, then excess androgen would not have been there. So because it is decreased, there is free androgen in the circulation. That's why we are having hirsutism. An increased ratio of LH to FSH. LH is increased, FSH is reduced. Usually it is in the ratio of 3:1. Lipid panel to rule out dyslipidemias. You have to do an OGTT, oral glucose tolerance test. You give 100 grams of glucose, then do the blood sugars after 2 hours. You get 1 reading with that, or you do a fasting and 3 hours, 1 hour apart, then you can come to a conclusion. There are certain parameters which is abnormal and normal. We have to follow that. Then prolactin should be done to rule out prolactinomas. Prolactinoma is a tumor of the pituitary gland. Then thyroid functions have to be done to rule out hyper or hypothyroidism. Then dehydroepiandrosterone sulfate and to assess adrenal androgens. As Dr. Shilpa already told that adrenal androgens are produced purely from adrenal glands. If at all it is in very excess, maybe there is an adrenal tumor, you have to rule out that. Okay, next. ultrasound. This is a very easy one, non-invasive. It's very easy for the patients also, very comfortable. Ultrasound, especially transvaginal ultrasound, that gives you a very clear picture. It's a sensitive and specific tool for detecting PCOS. Limitations are there because in adolescents, the unmarried girls, we do not want to do a transvaginal one. We can go with the transabdominal one, that is equally good. Next. What is the criteria, ultrasound criteria to diagnose PCO? You should have 12 or more subcapsular follicular cysts, 2 to 9 mm in diameter, and or there is an increase in the ovarian volume, more than 10 mm. Next. Peripherally situated cysts. Can you see the TR cysts in the periphery? That is very typical of PCO. Next. Then common features of PCOS, the metabolic syndrome. In PCOS, you have insulin resistance, obesity, risk of type 2 diabetes, dyslipidemia, hypertension, and irregular menses, hirsutism, and acne. In metabolic syndrome, you have insulin resistance, obesity, type 2 diabetes, dyslipidemia, and hypertension. There may not be hirsutism, acne, or irregular menses. Next. So how do you manage? You come to a diagnosis, you made the diagnosis, patient is having PCOS. How are you going to manage? There are three methods. One is non-pharmacological, other one is pharmacological, other surgical. Non-pharmacological, mainly this is weight reduction. So weight loss more than 5% of previous weight alone itself is beneficial in mild hirsutism. If it is mild hirsutism, mild PCOS, then just reducing weight itself is enough, and there's no other treatment, no need for any other treatment. It restores the hormonal value, then it increases secretion of sex hormone binding globulin from liver, thereby reducing testosterone level. It reduces insulin level. These are the benefits of weight loss. Lifestyle, if at all anybody is smoking, please quit. That is going to lower the E2 level and it raises DHEA and androgen levels, because smoking causes that. So what are you going to do to reduce weight? There are tips. Can you see? Is it visible? Okay. So what are the do's? High fiber intake. Eat lots of fiber. Makes you feel full and keeps you from overeating. Frequent small meals, and this will help you strengthen the metabolism. And flax seeds. If you add flax seeds to your regular diet, it is good. It's very beneficial. And seafood is also very healthy. Then green vegetables. That should be a must. What you should not eat? Say no to dairy products. Say no to high glycemic foods and red meat and saturated fats and refined grain. These things you have to avoid. So you drink plenty of fluids, especially water, not fluids which contain lots of sugar, but high fiber diet, green leafy vegetables. Say no to junk food. In one single word, I can say homemade food is the best, which contains all the nutrients and limited carbohydrates and adequate proteins and fat. I think that should be the best. Next. What's a pharmacological treatment? To maintain regular cycles, you'll have to give oral combined pills. Oral combined pills usually will give estrogen and progesterone, but here in hyperandrogenism, you give anti-androgenic. So you give OC with sepiapterone acetate, OC with spironolactone, and ketoconazole also said to reduce testosterone level. That is also being tried nowadays. Next. See, sepiapterone acetate is a synthetic progestin, competitive inhibition at androgen receptor. It is used with ethinyl estradiol in low doses. We give 30 to 50 microgram of ethinyl estradiol along with 100 mg of sepiapterone acetate. This allows regular menstrual bleeding, excellent contraception, also treatment of acne and hirsutism. How do that? They suppress LH secretion, they increase sex hormone binding globulin. So circulating androgen levels is reduced. So free testosterone is reduced. And there is estrogen decrease conversion of testosterone to dihydrotestosterone. Next. Metformin. This is mainly used in impaired glucose tolerance. PCOS patients are prone for developing diabetes, type 2 diabetes. So you get metformin. This is a mygonite. It inhibits hepatic glucose production. It decreases intestinal glucose absorption. And it increases peripheral insulin sensitivity. Actually, there is insulin resistance in PCOS. So this increases the sensitivity. It also reduces total and free testosterone and increases sex hormone binding globulin. Next. So what exactly we need to do in PCOS, when there is menstrual dysfunction, you can give, modify your lifestyle. Along with that, you give contraceptive pill. Maybe you can add metformin if the patient is obese. If she is lean, you can avoid. If it is hypnotism, again, lifestyle modification, combined pills, plus metformin, plus anti-androgenic. If it is hyperandrogenemia, all four you have to do. Lifestyle modification, combined pill, metformin, and anti-androgen. If it is only obesity, no other symptoms are there, you just modify your lifestyle, keep exercising, whether it is walking or jogging or exercise, along with dieting. Then, if there is type 2 diabetes mellitus or impaired glucose tolerance, you do modify your lifestyle, plus you give metformin. And also psychological support is very important, because when girls have hirsutism, they try to inhibit themselves from socializing. They do not want to come out of the house, or they do not want to mingle with anybody because of their excessive hair growth. They feel shy because they have beard like thing, because friends are asking, what is this, you have a beard? So they feel really very left out. For such people, psychological support is very important. Say that, tell them that there's definitive treatment for that. It is not a untreatable disease. So they can come forward, take treatment, take advice from doctors, go for counseling, and then get rid of their problems. And we can do surgeries also, not in adolescents, in infertile people. We can go for ovarian drilling, especially laparoscopic ovarian drilling. And in this, what we do is we try to burn all the cysts, not all, at least a few of the cysts, and then the number of cysts is reduced, the ovulation increases, and that gives us good results with after we induce ovulation in such patients. A lot of patients with PCOD, we've done many cases like that. We've got good results also. Once we induce ovulation after doing laparoscopic drilling, the results are really good. There are certain advantages of that and disadvantages also. I don't want to cover that. Next. And there's some treatment permanent, which is permanent for hirsutism. That's called electrolysis. Here, this is the only type of hair removal approved by the FDA as a permanent way of removing hair. This is a real great option for girls with hirsutism. There is permanent removal of the hair. It's not very painful. You can go for it if at all. That is, hirsutism is really troubling you. You can go for it. What are the long-term risks? She already has covered it. Why we have to treat PCOS? Because PCOS, many of them will have PCOS, but most of them will be, they do not go to the doctors, or they're not concerned, because it is not troubling. Anybody who goes to the doctor is because they have some pain somewhere. If there is no pain, I'm just fat, that's all, nothing else. And there's no other problem. I just have some little hair on my face, that is all. So there's no need to see a doctor. That's what they think. But in PCOS, you cannot take things so lightly, because long-term effects are really bad. They can develop diabetes, heart diseases, hypertension, dyslipidemia, endometrial cancer. Because there is hyperestrogenic state, they can develop endometrial cancer in later stages. Then breast cancer, that's also because of hyperestrogenic state. Recurrent pregnancy loss and ovarian failure after surgery. That's after, if at all we have done ovarian drilling, extensive ovarian drilling, then maybe patient can go for premature ovarian failure. We have to avoid. Next. Okay, that's it. I think everybody's understood how a PCOS patient presents and how she can be treated, and how important it is to get treated and not to neglect it. Thank you.
it was a very informative session regarding the diagnosis part of PCOS, including the thyroid, how it is analyzed to metabolic disorder, and also the management part with respect to weight loss and also the dietary plans, lifestyle factors, and also the laparoscopic corrections. Thank you, ma'am. Now I welcome all the dignitaries to raise the dais now.
Lakshmi.
Now I request Professor Sapna for the oath of thanks.
A very good evening. It was really a very wonderful session, ma'am, because we have seen, even I'm a person with PCOD. The thing is, it happened because I was very happy when you said that teachers are supposed to do a lot of activity even outside the classroom. We don't restrict ourselves only to the department or to the subject what we are teaching. As ma'am comes from zoology, I come from journalism. As you told, yes, we have a lot of responsibilities, because at individual level, there are a lot of things we can do, which we are trying to do. And there is also something we can do at the institutional level, not what we are trying to organize in the campus on a regular basis, collaborating with ma'am, and ma'am also collaborates with us, and we have been doing a lot of activities at the institutional level. But apart from being doing work at the individual and at the institutional level, there is something called for me and for ma'am as societal responsibility, because we treat our students, or maybe it can be boys or it can be girls, as one. Okay, I treat everybody as my friends also, but I know there are many a time students don't open up, and it is the responsibility of the teachers to identify those problems and bring it to the platform or bring it to the forum where we can discuss and where we can provide some solutions. And this program was conceptualized by ma'am with keeping in view that the problems many of our girls have, they may not share it with us, but we know that girls have one or the other kind of problems. I'm very happy that not only girls, even some of the boys are also there, maybe because of the compulsion, or maybe because you have your sisters at home, you have your friends in the group who will be suffering with these kind of things. As ma'am told, these kind of small things which is not treated on time might lead to many serious issues also. The main purpose of this particular session was to create that kind of an awareness, and also to sensitize you people about these issues, so that you people can open up and speak, because you're all educated students. We not have to tell you each and everything. So there is a responsibility, because health today is wealth. Okay, any person who is very healthy can achieve and can do a lot of things. So this is the first step what we're trying to do, especially related to this PCOD. I'm very happy that both of our doctors have given you a very insight, a deep insight to what the whole thing is all about, whether it is regarding the symptoms, whether it is regarding the kind of a treatment, what you are supposed to do. And these kind of awareness programs is very necessary at this kind of campuses, because we want to see that you people involved, not only you people get involved, but at the same time, you people can also spread a kind of awareness among your friends and among your family members. So on behalf of the Department of Zoology, Genetics and Radio Manasa, I thank Dr. Shilpa ma'am for being here and also for sharing her thoughts with us for the students. So it's just a small token of love and appreciation from us, ma'am. And I request Professor Malini ma'am to hand over this. I also thank Dr. Lata ma'am for being here. I'm very happy that you have been mentoring good students like Dr. Shilpa, which is always very much necessary. It's a very good duty for a student to remember their teachers. And I'm very happy. It's a small token of appreciation, ma'am. Thanks a lot for your time. I also thank Malini ma'am for being so supportive. I also thank our ICD people for airing this, or maybe we are streaming live. Many of the students who are not here will be able to see us and hear us on live, which I'm making use of all kind of technologies. I also thank our hostel wardens who were here. I also thank our senior faculty members like Amrita Valli ma'am is here, and also students both from journalism department, zoology, hostel students who are here with us, who have made this function a little bit a success, I should say. And we have arranged for the consultation. Now it will be open for consultation for students who can take up their issues with the doctors who will be giving you some guidance on those lines. We have two rooms. You can have the consultation in the room. Some people may don't want to happen it very live, or they don't want it to be more open. So we have arranged for the rooms there. You can just have the consultation. I thank one and all for being here and being a part. Hopefully people carry this message and spread, and also sensitize the friends and your family members. Thank you one and all.
Thank you, ma'am. I thank you for organizing this function in association with Radio Manasa also. Now we have 5 minutes break, and we will Amarnath, who will be picking all the names who wants the consultation. So after that, we'll be having the consultations according to the list, which is already there. Okay. So we'll have 5 minutes break. After that, we'll coordinate and we'll start the consultation. Thank you. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.